It's so wonderful to see new faces, and it's always fabulous to see returning faces. Good evening. Welcome to a year of courageous conversations in which together we explore how to foster greater inclusion and belonging in our community. I am Jessica Green, your co-host for the series, and along with Zena Jacques, Claire Nelson, and our Courageous Conversations team, we want to thank you for your interest and personal investment in this program. As we have entered the second half of this year-long series, we are thrilled to welcome those of you who are joining us for the first time, and welcome back to those who continue to return. Keep on coming. Each month since September, we have dipped our toes into topics that touch on understanding fear and bias, practicing mindfulness, active listening, and understanding white privilege. Tonight, we will be asked to contemplate what our role might look like in confronting prejudice. As organizers of this series, we are acutely aware that we cannot do these richly complex topics justice in our 2 short hours convened each month. But we hope that our time together serves as a starting point for courageous conversations as a community, and that perhaps each of us is inspired to continue exploring what inclusion and belonging means and looks like in your own life, with friends, family, colleagues, and neighbors. All of our sessions from the fall half can be found online at courageousconversations.us. Please also take the time to explore the many resources, guides, and blog posts on our website, and use the link for the survey to give us feedback on this pilot project. The series was designed to build on itself, and so we encourage you in your spare time to go back and watch the monthly sessions online to get the most out of your experience, or share them with a friend. In an effort to create space for honest sharing, we ask that as individuals in the room share their stories, please treat the information as sacred and let it remain with you upon leaving. Thank you. Also, we ask for phones to be switched off. Producing this series is a team effort, and we would be remiss not to acknowledge Barrington's White House, Barrington Area Library, Be Strong Together, Barrington Area Community Foundation, BMO Wealth Management, Sue and Rich Padula, Kim Duchessoa, and Urban Consulate for their partnership on this journey. Tonight's guest speaker, Janine Mohajir, is an educator, a storyteller, a mother, and a believer in building relationships across the lines that separate us. I have the privilege of being a board member for the Chicago-based nonprofit Interfaith Youth Corps, and it is here where I have gotten to know Janine. As part of their mission to work with students in higher education, Janine serves in the instrumental role as the Senior Director of Student Leadership, where she oversees the creation and implementation of programs that invest in development of student and alumni leaders. For the last 11 years, Janine has served as a senior staff member at IFYC and has trained hundreds of young people from religious and secular backgrounds to be interfaith leaders who create a different story of engagement in our polarized world. When she can, Janine volunteers with Surratt Chicago, a neighborhood space that fosters a healthy community by supporting initiatives around service and worship, education, and arts and family life. Janine is deeply inspired by the stories from her family and her faith to create positive change at the intersections of gender, sexuality, race, and religion. I'm so thrilled that she's here with us tonight. Thank you, Janine. Before I introduce my co-host, Dr. Reverend Zena Jacques, I wanted to make a point of acknowledging the recent passing of Casey Handel, a beloved community member, friend of the series, local inspiration, and champion of tonight's topic, confronting prejudice. So Casey and I knew each other from high school. We both graduated class of 96 from BHS. And it was about a year ago that she and I sat down together to gather her thoughts on the Courageous Conversation series. I was interested in her input. Casey had enthusiastically volunteered to be a friend of the series and also to share her story with all of us. I hadn't imagined then that instead I would be sharing with you now that Casey recently lost her battle with cancer. It is in the spirit of honoring Casey and her demonstration of courage and curiosity in the face of personal discrimination that we share her family's story with you tonight. So before Zena comes up, we're going to show a quick video that explains her story. And for those of you who knew and loved Casey, if this is something that is going to be sensitive for you, now's the time to step away while we play the video. Thank you.
Okay. Casey Handel and Zadette Rosado are getting married next week, so when someone recently stole their pride flag from their backyard and replaced it with an American flag, they not only felt violated, but under attack for their love.
The nerve of someone to trespass on someone's property and take something and then replace it with something that's making a statement. We
moved to Fox. Casey shared news of the caper with neighbors online.
Something very disturbing and scary happened last night.
And the neighborhood's true colors came shining through. One by one, neighbors started flying pride flags too, a message of solidarity with Casey and Zadette, but also a message to the thief.
Families come in all shapes and sizes, and it's not our right to judge, except it's our right to accept.
The couple's daughters, Peyton and Reese, originally thought someone stole the flag because they liked it so much.
It was tough to watch them then process the fact that maybe they took the flag because they didn't like it. For us, I think that was a difficult conversation to have with them.
On Christmas, however, thanks to a neighborhood support, the smiles are back, the pride even stronger. Ron Mott, NBC News, Barrington, Illinois.
So how do you confront prejudice? How do you choose to stand up, stand with, stand together? How do you confront prejudice? That was an example. And it was an example that was borne out by more than Casey and Zadette. Did you see what happened? Flags appeared everywhere. Did you hear what happened? Her neighbor said, "Not ours to judge." How do you confront prejudice? Yes, it can happen alone. But what happens when we confront it together? I say this so often. You have a Baptist pastor in front of you, so you're subject to biblical text. But not a sacred text in this moment, though it is to me. It really is in this moment just really good literature. In a book whose name we know as Ecclesiastes, but in the Hebrew it's Koheleth, which means the teacher. In that book, in fourth chapter, there's this wonderful little piece of text, and it says, what happens when two, I should not paraphrase it if I can make my phone work. Okay, all right. Two are better than one because they have a good return for their labor. If one falls down, the other can help him up. But pity the one who falls, who is alone. Again, if two lie down together, they keep warm. But how can one keep warm alone? And moreover, a threefold cord is not easily broken. Thank you, Reverend Lisa Ertlejohn, for borrowing one of your pieces. Think about this. If this was only one cord, the ability to snap it, the ability to pull it, is much easier than if it's two. But when you put the three together, its strength is increased. Its power to withstand multiplied exponentially. A threefold cord is not easily broken. That was a threefold cord. It was Casey, and then it was Casey and Zadette, and then it was their community. Beloved, we've come to try and figure out, come to try and practice how to confront prejudice. Tonight, we become the threefold cord. You, me, and we. That's our threefold cord. And when we are braided together, all of the pulling of hate loses its power. Casey offered a quote that you really must hear. These are her words. She said, "In a perfect world, I'd love to have a conversation with the person and find out why they chose to do what they did. Maybe share with him or her that we are all human and should be spreading love and kindness and not hate. That's a threefold cord. She and the person learning together to change the world. Tonight, let's see how we might braid ourselves together, how we might confront racism standing up, that's me. Standing with, that's you. Standing together, that's us. Let's get started.
That's a really hard act to follow, but I will try. Thank you everyone for having me here. My name is Janan Mohajer. I work at the Interfaith Youth Corps, which is a small nonprofit based out of Chicago that works with colleges and universities across the country on issues of religious diversity. I wanted to spend our time together in the beginning with sharing a story that's a very personal one to me, and it's almost 3 years to the date. So as Jess mentioned in my introduction, I'm aside from being a professional who works 40, 50 hours a week, I'm also a mom. I have 3 children, 8, 5, and 4. And exactly 3 years ago, we learned on Super Bowl Sunday, or on Super Bowl weekend, we woke up on Saturday morning and learned that a synagogue that was about 10 minutes away from our home in the south side of Chicago had been vandalized. The front doors of that synagogue were smashed. There were swastika stickers posted on either side of the smashed space. The act had been captured on the security cameras, but they weren't able to identify who had done it. And as my husband and I kind of sat at the breakfast table that morning with our children, we were kind of thinking about, what does it mean in this moment to be a neighbor? What does it mean to know that a house of worship that's 10 minutes away from where we live, a building that I could walk to from where I work during my lunch hour, was assaulted in the dark of night through this act of cowardice? So we were sitting, we were having conversation, we were figuring out, do we just show up? Do we call? Do we take people with us? Like, what do we do? And in the midst of that, our oldest son, who at the time was 5, who had just been through half a year of kindergarten, spoke up and asked a question. Will the man who broke that window break our window too? Now, to give you a little bit of contextualization, this was February of 2017. We had just witnessed masses of people at airports all around the country protesting against the travel ban. We had witnessed probably the most polarizing election we have had in our lifetime. And we were still in the rawness of that conversation when this act occurred at the Chicago Loop Synagogue. And we had noticed that our son, who was 5, he's the tallest one in this picture, had started coming home with questions about otherness. He had asked us not too many weeks before this question, you know, if people find out that I'm Muslim at school, will they take me away? Am I white or brown or neutral? What's my skin color? And we come from a multiracial family. My husband is half Irish American, half Palestinian. My parents are from the subcontinent. They're from India, and they migrated here when I was a teenager. So he was asking all of these questions about identity and otherness, while at the same time asking questions about safety. That conversation could have been one where we made him feel better, where we said, you're safe, our home is safe, our neighbors are safe, where we said, you know, our neighborhood is predominantly African American, and Muslims are actually pretty safe in African American neighborhoods because African Americans are, a lot of them are Muslim and know Islam really well. We could have done all of that, and those would have all been good paths to walk down. But there was something sitting at our breakfast table with us that morning that said, what happens the next time he witnesses something like this? And what happens at the next conversation we have about an incident like this? So we turned to Suleiman, his name is Suleiman, Solomon in Arabic is Suleiman, and asked, what do you want to do? What do you think we should do right now? And he said, well, I think we should make some cards. And we should go. So I was like, okay. So we made some cards. We made some hilarious rainbow flared cards and bought some flowers from Trader Joe's, and we showed up at the Chicago Loop Synagogue in the middle of a snowstorm on Super Bowl Sunday. And we weren't there for very long. We were there for maybe 20 minutes because it was really cold. We had enough of a community that we knew that somebody would be there so we could drop off what we had brought with us so that they could witness the space that had been violated and they could witness that there were adults there trying to fix what had happened. So it wasn't this abstract story. So coming out of that conversation, we decided that it wasn't just enough for this small acts to be part of the conversation. But it was important to continue learning and to continue inculcating what it means to be a good neighbor, what it means to step into the space when someone needs someone to step into the space, and what are the ways that we do that in different conversations. A quote that I had earlier that I skipped over is a quote by the poet Rumi, who said, "The wound is where the light enters you." So the possibility of building something often comes when something is broken. And the possibility of expanding boundaries often comes when those boundaries can be shattered. So that was that moment that we chose as parents to really lean into that. Now, as a professional who had been doing bridge building work through IFYC, through Interfaith Youth Corps, for the last, at that point, 10 years, this question from my five-year-old was like a dagger in my heart, as you can imagine. And it was incidentally during this time that we were asking the question of, what does it mean to be an upstander? Who's heard of that word before? A couple of you? Yeah? Great. We'll talk a little bit more about that in just a minute. What does it mean to actually put yourself in a space, whether it is in a physical space, whether it's online, that allows people to build community again, and that you are a person leading that conversation? So a lot of what we'll do today comes from a lot of the learning that I did as a professional, but also as a mother in those spaces, and developing this rubric that we have of what it means to be an upstander. How do we respond in moments of prejudice? How do we respond both in the immediacy of something happening, but also how do we then rebuild, and what does it mean to then come together in the aftermath of something happening that fractures the spaces that we're a part of? So to start off, I wanted to tell you a little bit about Interfaith Youth Corps that kind of grounds the methodology with which this work is carried for me. So at IFYC, we often say diversity is a fact, right? This room is a diverse room. All that we know about a room when we say a room has diversity is that there are different people in that room. We don't know what's happening between all of those people, right? Pluralism is an accomplishment. It is the positive engagement of diversity to build community. It is the positive engagement of diversity that brings people who orient around religion differently together into a space to both celebrate their shared values, but also to lean into their differences. So that the differences that we have are not obstacles, but rather they are also assets that help us understand each other further. So there's three parts of pluralism that we often talk about. What are the three parts? And those are these three bullets on the bottom. The first is respect for various religious identities. And when we say religious identities, we include non-religious outlook in that as well. So people who identify as secular or humanist or spiritual but not religious are also part of that conversation, because that table needs to contain all of those different perspectives. The second part of pluralism is building mutually inspiring relationships. So recognizing that it's not just enough to respect one another and to know about one another, but it's important to also build a relationship with someone, to hear their story and to share your story in return. And the third part of pluralism is engaging in common action around issues of shared concern. So not just to have a space where you share stories and come together for dinner and barbecues and potlucks, but also thinking about what comes after that. How do we build community that engages in common concern? Which is a lot of the work that you all are doing here through this series. right? It's starting those conversations around common, around issues of common concern. So to think about this as a grounding for the conversation we're about to have, I also want to recognize that the conversation that we'll have tonight, and of the many conversations that you probably have had before tonight and will have after tonight, these are difficult to do. And that requires a lot of trust in this space. And it also requires us to bring our full selves to the table, as well as trust in the selves that are being represented around the table. So what I'll ask you to do is consider something that we call Chatham House Rules. Who's heard of Chatham House Rules? A couple people? So Chatham House Rules is basically, to use a phrase, what's learned here can leave here. So the lessons, the themes, what you're learning from this space can leave with you. But what's heard here, that's a first person account, should probably stay in this space in order to respect some confidentiality. So don't share your neighbor's story on Facebook tonight. Probably not a good idea. But if there is something that you learned from this space that you would like to share, feel free to share that. Is that cool? Does everybody agree on that? Yes? Yes? Great. So I wanted to move us into, this is the picture that I'm not good at moving slides. I'm like one of those people who just speaks, and hopefully someone should move our slides. This was supposed to be my representation of diversity, and this was my representation of pluralism, when you get together to take some selfies. that was a joke, by the way. Pluralism is more than selfies. So I wanted to spend a little bit of time talking about what this word means, bystander effect. Who's heard of this in the room? A couple of you? Great. So we're going to watch a video that gives us an example of what it means to be a bystander. This video is from the 1970s, so the quality is not super great, so I ask for your recognition and grace with that. Thank you. The second scenario is the same scenario, but with other people in the room. So, yep. So, what did we just see? We can take some, I would love some comments, just popcorn style. So speak up if you feel compelled to do so. Yes?
The fear of what other people would think of her overrode common sense.
That's exactly right, right? When the young woman was in the room by herself, it took her maybe a couple minutes to be like, I'm getting the heck out of here, right? Whereas in the second scenario, you see her sitting and struggling with it for almost 20 minutes where she's like, do I get up? Is this normal? What's happening? And that's essentially what bystander effect is. It's when we start to question what the action is that we're supposed to do, and therefore we don't take action at all. And the environment around us actually has a huge part to play in the decisions that we make in those moments. What are some other things people noticed?
The fact that nobody else was reacting made her question her own instinct.
That's exactly right. The fact that no one else noticed made her question what her instincts were.
She always seemed really close to saying something. Like she just kind of
looking
around, and she always looked like she was just about to speak.
She was always on the verge, but second-guessed herself into not speaking. Some of the things that you all just mentioned are what we would call barriers to intervention, right? Things that stop us from intervening when a situation is inviting that of us, sorry.
Well, also at the end, did she just leave and leave all the other people behind?
No, I think at the end she finally got someone's attention who was in charge. Yeah, yeah. Because the rest of that room, I'm not sure if this was obvious, the rest of the room were actors. So the rest of the people in the room were pretending not to see the smoke in order to see what she does. Yeah. So these are what we call some barriers to intervention. And this is actually comes from various bystander trainings, or what we call upstander trainings, that many organizations have come together to create. Some of them I'll name for you. Feel free to look them up. There's one called Green Dot that does some specific work around bullying or anti-bullying. There's Facing History in Ourselves that also has an upstander training. Those are two that I'm familiar with that a lot of this is inspired from as well. So here are some barriers for training. The first barrier is safety, because people are wondering, is it safe for me to step in? Is it okay for me to step in? Is it gonna harm me if I step in? And that's the question that a lot of us are asking when faced with a situation where we're seeing an act of prejudice. The second is something called diffusion of responsibility. So it's saying, you know what, there's other people here, I don't have to be the person who steps in. Someone else can step in for me, right? Or someone else can step in to help. And that's another barrier to intervention. Another is internalized bias, right? We see this a lot when it comes to issues around gender. You'll hear questions, or you'll hear people say, well, you know, I don't know the situation, and you know, maybe she wasn't wearing the right clothes, I don't know, right? So there's like those kinds of internal biases that we all carry that we really have to think about. There's unclear circumstances, right? That you're questioning, this is what you saw in the video, like you're questioning, like, am I reading this situation incorrectly? Is it actually not that big of a deal? Like, am I just wrong? Am I not understanding what's happening? And that's part of the conversation as well. And the final one is communal influence. So it's really kind of looking around you and seeing what other people are doing, and then falling in line and acting in the same way, because you don't want to be the one who's different. And you don't want to step out of what your friends and community are doing. So I want to give you all a little bit of time at your tables to turn to each other and to think about, in these five common barriers to intervention, which of these really sits with you? Which of these is the one that you're like, that one feels really challenging, or that one feels like it would be the biggest obstacle for me? And we'll give you about 5 minutes to do that. So we're going to pivot into, what does it actually mean or look like to be an upstander? Right? What does it look like to overcome some of these barriers and to actually step into a conversation or a situation where you're required to take some of these risks and perhaps intervene in a situation? So we're going to watch another video. This, to give you a little bit, has anyone seen this before?
Yeah.
Some of you have? Yeah, the young people in the room have. this is actually a campaign that was put out by Burger King. It's around bullying. But I think it speaks to some of the things that we're talking about in this space. So let's watch this video.
Please stop.
Fine.
Dude, ow.
Fine.
Stop.
Fine.
Ow, stop.
Do you have any friends?
Yes, I heard you.
What are you even doing here? It's almost too easy.
Ow, stop.
Ow. Come on.
I get it.
Maybe
get
you are
it.
A little bit more.
Ooh.
You think you're special? One more Virginia meal.
Dude, stop.
hot.
You're fine. Oh.
I just opened it up and it's all smashed.
Did you order bullied or unbullied?
Bullied or unbullied?
Yeah.
Do you have a manager that I can speak to? Because that doesn't even make any sense.
Hi, your manager.
Hi, how's it going? I was given this.
Did you bully this burger?
Well, yeah. This is a defenseless Whopper Jr. It can't defend itself.
You don't mean anything by it.
It's just for laughs.
It's just for laughs.
Just give me my burger, man.
What the is going on here?
What are you? Is there something wrong with you?
Because that's clearly what happened.
Can't be serious.
Had you seen me bullying this burger, would you have stood up and said something?
Yeah.
It's good to know.
Are you okay?
Yeah, I'm okay.
Yeah? What's your name?
Reese.
Hi, Reese.
We're just having fun.
You having fun? He's not having fun. So therefore, I think you guys should just leave him alone.
Later. This feels better to me.
Have you ever been, like, messed with before?
Oh, my God. This is, like, the ideal world is where if somebody else sees, like, something weird happening, that they'll come over and be like, hey, this is not okay.
Yeah.
To feel defenseless, that's the one of the worst things in the world. I've been that kid, so if I see it, I'm gonna do something about it. And I hope there's more people out there like that.
So we're actually going to break down some of the things that you saw people do in this video into what... Sorry, I am not technologically savvy. There we go. Into five different ways that you can act as an upstander and actually intervene in a situation. So for right now, what I would like us to think about is a situation where something is live, like you're witnessing something happening. That's what we're going to be talking about for the next few minutes. And then we're going to take these same skills and we'll apply them to other kinds of situations. Two specific ones. One where it's something online that's happening, where you're not in a physical space, but you're in a virtual space. And second, what happens after something happens at a specific location and you find out about it in the aftermath? For example, like the video that you saw of the family whose flag was stolen, or the story that I told earlier about the synagogue being vandalized. What do you do in response to something like that? But for right now, we're going to look at what happens in a live situation. What are some things that you can do? The first thing that's recommended is direct connectly with the person being targeted. So if you look at upstander curriculum from various different organizations around the country, nobody will tell you to actually talk to the person perpetrating the issue, right? Everybody will say what you're supposed to do is actually connect with the person being targeted so as to form some kind of circle, realistically or real or figurative, around them to let them know, hey, I see you. You have somebody in your circle here, right? The second thing that you can do is create a diversion or change the subject. Now, this typically looks, it's related to the third one, which is using body language and positioning to change the power dynamic. This looks like that young woman, Fawz Mirza, who actually took her tray and walked over to the other table and like placed herself next to the kid who was being bullied. Right? So she actually, and then she didn't just talk to him, she talked to the other kid being like, what's your name? And she changed the conversation that was happening so that they weren't continuing down the path that they had started. The third is using body language or positioning to shift the power dynamic, which is again the same move that you see Fawz doing, which is to put herself in a non-threatening way next to the person who's being targeted and to start a conversation so that she diffuses the other conversation that's happening and that conversation doesn't feel urgent or relevant anymore. The fourth is locating people around you and enlisting them to help. This is recognizing that sometimes it's not safe for us to be the people stepping into that situation. Sometimes you need to bring other people into that room, right? What if another young person who was witnessing that in the Burger King had gone to the manager of the store or of the restaurant and been like, hey, I think this is happening, can you help, right? Or if that was happening at a grocery store, what if you went to the clerk at the front of the room and said, hey, I noticed something on aisle 5, can you take care of that, right? So getting other people who may have more authority than you or more ability to step in to help them step in. And the fifth finally being continuing to support the victim. And this is basically recognizing that people will need space to process what is happening around them. People will also need allies. So in the aftermath, sometimes what you may have to do is step in and say, I can be your witness, right? If they're filing, if they choose to file a report, for example, you can be their witness. Or you can say, I'm gonna stand here with you until your ride comes, right? Things like that, which is continuing to support them. So the thing that I wanna make sure that these five things speak to, these five steps speak to, is that the center of attention should always be with the person or people who are being targeted and not with those who are perpetuating the targeting, right? Because we don't wanna give those people more power than they already have in that situation. And engaging with them directly does exactly that, right? It elevates the situation. Any questions around that? Okay, so what I'd like for you to do now is actually go back to your tables, think of these five steps, and think of which of these steps feels really easy to you, that you feel really comfortable, like, oh, I could do that. And think of which of these steps feels really difficult and challenging, like, oh, I'm not sure I can do that one, right? So think of those two things, and I'd love for you to share a little bit with your table again. So here's scenario one. You're walking through the produce section of your grocery store when you witness a situation. You see a man yelling bigoted statements at a Muslim woman who is shopping with two younger children by her side. You hear words like terrorist and go back to your country. What do you do? All right, we're gonna go to scenario two. So same thing, think about how you would respond. The local synagogue near you has been vandalized. Congregants arrive for Torah study group on Saturday morning to discover that the front door has been spray painted with a swastika and an anti-Semitic slur. Police have been notified and have opened an investigation. What do you do? So go back to your tables, and then I'll pull you back in a few minutes. I think what's important in these situations is also to think about when something like this happens that's not necessarily in your neighborhood, but may affect people who live in your neighborhood. For example, you know, there's been a number of instances in the last year, unfortunately we can name probably more than a few of them, but what happened at the Tree of Life Synagogue in Pittsburgh, what happened in Christ Church in New Zealand, those are two large incidents of violence. And I remember after the Tree of Life happened, I had spoken at a modern Orthodox synagogue in Chicago a few months before that, and I called the rabbi and I was like, are you guys okay? Like, do you need anything? You know I live on the south side and you're on the north side, so we're not exactly in the same space, but let me know. Like, do you want some roast chicken? Like, let me know, right? So those kinds of gestures are also really important, because even though the act of violence may not have happened in your neighborhood or in the synagogue of your friend, they are feeling that, right? They are feeling that very much in their space as well. Christ Church is another example. I know personally I was very affected by Christ Church because I, even though it was not in North America, I felt very, for lack of a better word, naked in that moment, right? I felt very much, my hijab, the scarf that I wear around my hair, makes me very visibly Muslim in a way that is unmistakable and feels like it's very easy to be targeted in that moment. But what it also does is it gives people a way to connect with me, and that's what I really appreciated in the aftermath of Christ Church, is the amount of text messages and Facebook outreach and calls and lots of those kinds of things that happen. I know at IFYC, when the Pulse shooting happened in Florida, a bunch of us got together and said, let's write cards. So we found the address of the Pulse nightclub, and we basically like wrote 40 cards and like mailed them out to the nightclub, which would have been lovely for them to receive in the weeks of after they had been processing this very big crime that had happened in their community. So kind of thinking about how do we show up in those spaces, even when maybe the vicinity of the crime is not immediate to you, but how do you show support? How do you show solidarity? How do you physically show up, virtually show up? What does that look like? Cool. We're gonna do one more scenario, and this one's a little bit more tricky. So, this is online. So scenario three, a picture of a young woman, this is a real story, this picture, is posted on Reddit. Everybody knows what Reddit is in here, right? Most people do. Reddit is Gen Zers should explain Reddit for me, because I'm a Gen Xer. Reddit is basically this online community where you can have lots of good and terrible conversations. And there is a thread on Reddit called Funny Things. So someone posted this picture on the funny thread with the comment, I don't know what to make of this. And as soon as that is posted, there are hundreds of messages making fun of, questioning the gender of, making assumptions about this young woman who IFYC knows really well because she's one of our students and alumni. And what do you do? What do you do? The picture of your friend or somebody you know or somebody you don't know goes viral with lots of negative repercussions. If you're on Facebook and you come across that, if you're on Twitter and you come across that, if you're on Facebook and Twitter and you see your kids coming across that, what do you do? So let's go back to your tables for a few minutes, and then I'll pull you back out. So instead of taking scenario comments back from you, I'm actually going to tell you a little bit about what happened in this story. So, because this is a hard one. So her name is Balpreet. Balpreet is a Sikh woman. Sikh is a faith. It comes out of India. Sikh. S-I-K-H. How many of you have heard of the Sikh community and know people? Great, awesome. There's actually, I think, a Sikh Gurdwara not too far from here in Palatine, if I remember correctly. So the Sikh community is very much, a lot of their core teaching is around how they connect with the divine and how they connect with the divine specifically around acts of service. And for Balpreet, one of the ways that she lived out her faith was to deprioritize the way that she looked because she wanted to put that energy into her acts that she did in this world. And that was a very conscious choice that Balpreet was making. So Balpreet sees this picture go viral on Reddit, and the reason she finds out is because her friend says, your picture's on Reddit, and a lot of people are commenting on it. And so she decides that what she's gonna do is she's gonna respond, and she's gonna post a comment on Reddit. So we're gonna hear from her.
I was in line for breakfast, checking my email, and someone took a picture of me. They posted it on Reddit and labeled it as, I'm not sure what to conclude from this. But that kind of prompted onslaught of comments that were trying to label me into a gender or into a religion or into an ethnicity. So I chose to respond. Yes, I'm a baptized Sikh woman with facial hair. Yes, I realize that my gender is often confused and I look different than most women. However, baptized Sikhs believe in the sacredness of this body and must keep it intact as a submission to the divine will. And then the whole entire internet was in a frenzy. I read the comments, I read all the positive comments and the negative comments, and the positive comments made me cry, actually, not the negative ones, because I didn't see the compliments as a reflection of myself. I saw them as a reflection of the ideals that I hope to embody one day. People saw my response and they were very inspired. And I was inspired by the original poster who apologized right afterwards. And I thought people were getting caught up in the fact that I had replied in such a clear manner that they were forgetting the fact that he apologized. And I thought that was more noteworthy, you know, because it's easy for me to defend myself. It's easy for me to explain myself, but it's hard to kind of look within yourself and realize your mistake and fix it and publicly announce that you fixed it in front of the internet, which it's scary for people. So I think he deserves a lot more attention than I do. When I first started tying a turban, I went to school and I remember feeling just so paranoid. I put my head down because I did not want to deal with the people staring at me. From that moment on, I think something changed within me because I realized that I was scared of who I was and trying to explain that to people. And through finding myself in situations that required me to talk about myself and be fearless while doing it, I guess that just kind of all happened to be present in that one moment. Dr. Martin Luther King said, you can't fight hate with hate, you can fight hate with love. And I would tell anyone to do that. Try to find the love within themselves and fight hate with it. Sikhs are told that that is their greatest weapon, is love, love for the divine. And if you let that become your sword and your shield, then the whole world is your oyster. As college students, we are the people that are going to change the world. I've seen that happen. I have seen people my age changing the world, whether that be through social media, through nonprofit work, through just, you know, volunteering their time. They are changing communities, and in turn, they're inspiring younger generations to also do the same, to overstep their potential.
So one of the things that we see in this video is that, first of all, when Balpreet saw that happen, she went to her immediate group of friends who happened to be interfaith fellows with IFYC to basically be like, what do I do? And a few of us kind of helped coach her into thinking about, because she wanted to respond, but she didn't want to be defensive, and she wanted to invite a conversation rather than close it. So we a few of us worked with her to develop her response. But what was really uplifting was to see the transformation of the conversation online. Once, not only once she had posted, but once she had posted it and the support for her started kind of gaining momentum on this thread, right? To the point where obviously even the poster, who didn't necessarily mean ill, he wasn't malicious in his intent, but he was kind of poking fun at it a little bit. But he even reached out, drafted a response, and then put up his own apology on the original thread as well. If any of us have been on Twitter in the last, 24 hours, 2 hours, we know that that's probably not how most scenarios work out on the internet. Most scenarios probably go the opposite route, right? Where a person is ridiculed, there's lots of back and forth, there's lots of talking past each other, and it's unfortunately a space that's very volatile and very quick to explode. Partially what our responsibility is in that space, to think of those five elements, is how do we translate that to online spaces? And some of that is, again, to think of those actions in the same way. To basically put up a word or a line that says, hey, I hope you're okay, I'm thinking about you, right? Or to say, this is a really great website that has lots of information about the Sikh community, right? So kind of filling the gap instead of going against what I like to call the internet trolls, right? Or what we probably collectively call them. Instead of going head to head with someone who clearly is there to perpetuate the conversation, what you do is you keep introducing another space. And you keep introducing another point of contact that is not hateful. The other thing to remember about social media, especially if it's your social media, is you get to tell people if they want to what they're allowed to say on your walls, right? And that's something that I think people often forget, because there's this concept of like, oh, it's free speech, everybody should be allowed to say whatever they want to. Yes, and if it is your wall, you get to tell people whether they get to say hateful things on that wall or not. And that's something to think about as you also engage with this community online, which we will increasingly only become more engaged with, right? More and more of our life, and more of our social life in particular, is lived online than actually in real spaces these days. So that's something to think about also. So I wanted to close out tonight with a couple of different stories, and then I'm gonna hand it back over to the pastor. So this is a story I don't often tell. It's a very personal story, but I'm gonna take a risk with you all and tell it. So as I mentioned at the beginning of the hour, or beginning of the 2 hours, I'm in a multiracial marriage. My husband is half, his mother is Irish American from Pittsburgh, and his father is from Palestine. And in the months before our wedding, I was, you know, we were figuring out weddings, as you all can imagine. We're in a good venue for this, which has a lot of, wedding planning is often a very stressful space for a lot of couples. And in the midst of that conversation, my husband Ali was like, you know, I have some family who are not gonna be invited to our wedding. So I was like, okay. He was like, they are some of the Catholic part of my family. And I just have a really strenuous relationship with them because of some issues that we've had around racism, some things that they've said to me directly, some things that they've said to my siblings directly, specifically in this one man who was someone who was very close to Ali's mother, but unfortunately had been very racist in previous years, had said things like that S and N-word, sand N-word, to my husband and his siblings, who had said lots of very racist things about Muslims, who had served in the Iraq War with the Marines and had come back with a lot of prejudice against Muslim communities. So I was like, okay, that's fine. We don't have to invite him if you don't want to. It's your family. So we didn't invite him. 3 years after our marriage, and every Christmas we go back to visit my in-laws in Pittsburgh. My kids love it because they get to celebrate Christmas even though we don't celebrate Christmas. so they love it. And on our third year back, this is before my children were born, my husband pulls me aside at the airport and says, okay, so this person's gonna be at my mom's house. We tried to time around it, it just didn't work. I'm just letting you know, because he probably has not seen many other Muslim women with hijab outside of Iraq. Just letting you know. So I was like, okay. So I was a little nervous, had no idea what we were walking into. So we walked in, you know, we greeted everybody. I made sure to pick up like a Chicago t-shirt for him at the airport, just because we had gifts for everyone else in the family. And we get there and something shifted. Dude is my best friend. We ate dinner together, we played board games together. It was very strange to be in the presence and to realize that there was a lot of tension in the room, and at the same time, something had fundamentally shifted in the space. I registered it, I mentioned it to my husband, he was like, yeah, I don't really know what's going on. He came up to my husband at the end of our trip, which was about a week long, and said, you know, I owe you an apology from some things I said to you a long time ago. And he apologized for all the racist remarks that he had said to him about 5 years previous. And that was an interesting beginning for us. Now, it didn't change who he voted for. It didn't change his politics. It didn't change that he's a police officer who has very different opinions on police brutality and violence against black bodies than we do, right? And it's a relationship that is both very fraught with complexities, and at the same time, he's part of our family. And we have to figure out what it means to be in family with him. Last year, after Christchurch, a lot of mosques in the United States and around the world were on high security alert. Specifically as the holiday of Eid was coming into play at the end of the month of Ramadan, which is the holy month that Muslim fasts in. So on the day of Eid, or the day right before Eid, we call Ali's mom to like wish her, and our relative who was in the space with her asks to get on the phone with me. And he says, I just want you to know, I volunteered to go protect the mosque in our neighborhood. Right? And it was really touching. Still didn't change who he voted for. And I'm saying that because it's very easy to conflate those conversations, and it's very easy to say if you don't get everything, then the battle is lost, right? And what's important is to remember that sometimes we're in it for the long game. Sometimes it takes a number of years to build relationships. Sometimes it takes a number of personal risks. Only you can decide whether those risks are worth taking for you. Only you can decide whether those risks are something that you want to embark on. And if you choose not to, you are legitimate in that choice. But it is only through long investment that sometimes this shift begins to happen. A moment might spark someone to think differently, but it takes a long time for us to get to a point where change actually begins to manifest itself in actions and bodies. So I share that with you mostly to say, to not be discouraged when things don't happen quickly enough, to not be discouraged when there's yet another obstacle when you just solved one, because that's part and parcel of the conversation around what it means to confront prejudice and what it means to be an upstander. Since I started with Rumi at the beginning of the hour, I wanted to end with Rumi. At the beginning of the session of today, I said, the quote that I shared said something like, the wound is where the light enters you. This is another quote from Rumi that says, where there is ruin, there is hope for treasure. And this is just recognizing that sometimes we have to break out of our normalcies, we have to break out of our patterns, and we have to be ruined in order to find the treasures that we're seeking. and we have to build that back up together collectively. Thank you all for taking the risk with me today to have these conversations and for bringing your full selves to the table. And I hope that you'll continue to bring yourselves to these tables and to build more community from this day forward. So thank you.
Rumi also says, stop acting so small. You are the universe in ecstatic motion. Stop acting so small. You are the universe in ecstatic motion. That means the smallest move you make changes the universe. That means the one thing you take out of here tonight that you will enact means you're not acting small, but your ecstasy leaps off you onto somebody else and changes everything. And if it feels like too much for you alone, remember you're not. Who's the other two parts of your threefold cord? Who will you join with to increase your strength, to increase your ecstasy, to be your accountability partner so you'll have someone with whom to practice your ecstatic motion? Or maybe the more fundamental question is, will you? Will you? Will you take those 5 points? Will you put them on your refrigerator? Will you act? Stop acting so small. You are the universe in ecstatic motion. I started with, let's get going. Now I say, amen. Be well.